Think the world's coming to an end?
Well, there was a start to the world sometimes, so I guess there'd be a stop.
When I first saw it, I was bowled over by it.
You need more than luck in Shanghai.
I thought it was a hell of a picture.
Here's to crime. I want to make you a proposition. $5,000. All you have to do is kill somebody.
Mr. Grisby wants me to kill Mr. Grisby.
I'm not what you think I am.
I'm aiming at you, lover.
You're the killer.
When Orson Welles made The Lady from Shanghai, which was made sometime in 1946 and released in 1948, he was just getting over a kind of blacklist as a director. He'd made one of the best movies anybody'd ever seen called Citizen Kane, which didn't make any money because it was blacklisted by Hearst. And then he made The Magnificent Ambersons, which was truncated and recut and dumped on the marketplace, and that had failed. He'd produced a picture called Journey into Fear, which also was sort of let out of its cage rather than released. And basically at RKO, which is the studio he'd worked for, they had done the best they could to make him seem like an overrated genius who had taken them for a ride. So he continued to work in pictures as a sort of a star actor. So what he got out of Citizen Kane was that he was a movie star, sort of. As he said, well, I guess I was, because I starred in a movie, you know. In 1945, Sam Spiegel came to him and sort of broke the unspoken blacklist about hiring Welles as a director, and he became a director for hire and did a film called The Stranger, probably again because he was acting in it. In later years, Orson would say that it was the only film he ever directed, that he kind of didn't disown, but he thought it was the least of his work. Ironically, it was a successful film at the box office. It made money and got pretty good reviews. As he said, he could have gone on making films like that for the rest of his career and had a perfectly good career, but that's not what he wanted to do. Went back to the theater and produced and directed Around the World in 80 Days, a stage version of that, which was enormously expensive and difficult. And while preparing to open, he didn't have enough money for the costumes, so he wired Harry Cohn. Harry Cohn was the head of Columbia, it was his studio. Oh, there's a lot of stories about him. Bit of a vulgarian, supposedly, had his own opinion about things, but he took risks. And some people really liked him, respected him, other people hated him. Welles had a relationship with him, probably because he was married to Rita Hayworth, who was Harry Cohn's biggest star at Columbia. He got in touch with Harry Cohn and said he would make a picture for him, that he had a very good book in mind called The Lady from Shanghai, which couldn't have been the title unless he just made it up on the spot, because the book was called If I Die Before I Wake. The novel was owned by another producer named William Castle, who became known later as a kind of road company Alfred Hitchcock. But at the time, he was a young producer-director, so they knew each other. I think Castle gets some credit on the picture as an associate producer or something, and supposedly did some work on the script, although only Orson gets credit. But he got in touch with Harry Cohn and said if he buys the book, he'll make it as a picture. He'll send him $50,000. So he got the money to bail himself out of this problem on Around the World in 80 Days and made a commitment, basically, to direct a movie that, based on a book he ostensibly hadn't even read.
Please don't love me.
And around the time of Kane, Rita Hayworth was on her way to becoming the number one most popular pinup for the GIs in World War II. And supposedly Orson saw the famous pinup and said, I'm going to marry her one day, and did. The relationship was complicated. Rita supposedly was a very troubled woman who suffered from child abuse. This was just a lot of bad vibes underneath the surface, and Orson evidently did the best he could, but it was a difficult relationship.
Gilda, are you decent?
Me?
Around the time that this picture was first discussed, Rita was the biggest star at Columbia, and one of the biggest stars in the United States, in the world.
Sure, I'm decent.
And Orson was struggling, but certainly desirable factor as an actor. The role that Rita Hayworth ended up playing in the picture was originally intended, or in Orson's mind, for an actress who wasn't particularly known. I don't think he had any intention of making a star vehicle initially, but a small thriller. Their relationship was not doing so well, and it was evidently Rita's idea to do the picture with Orson. It was her hope that it might bring them closer together, and it did briefly, but they were divorced before the film actually opened. Orson decided that she would be better for this part if her hair was different than what everybody knew her as. Also, it was a different kind of Rita, as he said, than anybody had seen before. Certainly it didn't please Harry Cohen that his biggest star was having her hair cut and her signature red hair at that. I think it was a decision made not so much for publicity or to irritate Harry Cohen, but because he thought it was better for the part and better for the character that she have short hair and that it be blonde. And I think he wanted a new look that would go with a new character.
Good evening, said I, thinking myself a very gay dog indeed.
Orson thought it was funny, but sort of agreed with Harry Cohen when he said to him that he's never going to hire one person to direct and act the lead in a picture again. And Orson said, why? And Cohen says, because I can't fire anybody.
That's how I found her. And from that moment on, I did not use my head very much.
His character's not a typical leading man. He's easily fooled. He's trusting. And he falls for that character and gets himself into a big mess. He's sort of the innocent in the story.
O'Hara?
O'Hara.
You're what they call an able-bodied seaman?
Well, that's what they call it.
As usual with Orson, he tried to make the heavies more interesting and the hero more complicated, so everything was, you know, mixed up.
Money cannot bring you health and happiness, etc. Is that it? Without money, I'd be flat on my back in the ward of a county hospital.
Look, Everett Sloan had been introduced into movies in Citizen Kane and was one of the Mercury players. I asked him why he had made Bannister such an elaborate cripple. Well, Orson's answer was that he felt Everett Sloan was largely a radio actor and didn't move very well, and that he thought it would give him an interesting physicalization of the character. Orson sometimes liked certain actors and remembered them. Glenn Anders, he'd seen him in a film made in 1930 called Laughter. And he'd remembered Glenn Anders and thought he was a wonderful actor and cast him. And Anders does give a kind of really diabolically weird performance. A little target practice.
I was just doing a little target practice.
The picture did seem to have a kind of a cursed, what the French call maudit. Yes, it was a little bit damned. A crew member died and people got sick and Rita got sick for a long time. And the impression was that Orson had fallen behind because of the way of shooting. But in fact, Rita had gotten sick and they closed down for a month. Which when I mentioned to Orson that I had noticed this in the production reports, that they had had to close down because of her continued illness, Orson said, my God, you're right, I'd forgotten that. Maybe he'd begun to believe that it was his fault. I think with The Lady from Shanghai, which was shot on sound stages, but it was also shot on locations in Acapulco and San Francisco, and as usual with those scenes that are shot on real locations, they give the film an enormous breath, and you feel that, you know, this is happening. Orson was particularly good at handling locations, showing them off to their best ability. John Ford had said to me, most of the good things that happen in pictures happen by accident. And I repeated this to Wells, and Wells said, yes, you could even say that a director is a man who presides over accidents. He liked to create a set in which the possibility of something different than what he'd imagined or that what he'd planned would happen. He liked to leave it open. Well, shooting on location gives you much more of that feeling.
And what was I? Mike O'Hara, doing on a luxury yacht.
The yacht on which they shot belonged to Errol Flynn, who was a friend of Wells's, and supposedly Flynn was around for some of the shooting. There were also three cameramen on the picture. Charles Lawton gets sole credit, but Rudolph Maté, who then became a director later, also is credited. And then there was Joseph Walker, who also did all the Frank Capra pictures and probably was under contract to Columbia still. It speaks of the picture being shot in pieces in different places and also over a longish period of time. There were three other working titles on this film, besides If I Die Before I Wake, which is the novel's title. There was Black Irish, which referred to Wells's character, and Take This Woman, which obviously referred to Rita, and The Girl from Shanghai, which became The Lady from Shanghai.
How do you rate Shanghai? I worked there, too.
I think The Lady from Shanghai certainly falls into the film noir category, a kind of a crime thriller.
I don't know how to shoot.
It's easy. You just pull the trigger.
Very much a kind of a post-World War II genre. But I think Lady from Shanghai is one of the first in a funny way. It was made before some of the other ones were released.
Give me a cigarette.
It is pretty much in the film noir vein.
I'm learning to smoke now.
But it's more complicated, more grotesque, more bizarre, and darker, I think, than most crime pictures.
Goodbye.
You mean we can't win?
No, we can't win.
I think throughout Wells' films, he's often been accused of being needlessly flamboyant or pretentious or whatever, but usually you find that the background or the atmosphere has equal weight with the scene itself. And there are a number of set pieces.
$5,000, fella.
There's a scene with Glenn Anders and Wells overlooking the ocean.
I'll fill in the details later.
There's a kind of a sense of vertigo, a sense of insecurity, unstableness, not just in the sort of scene itself, but really in the way it's shot. And the precipitous feeling of it, that you could fall off into nothingness.
So long, fella.
That's true of so many scenes in the picture. The scene in the aquarium.
I've never seen an aquarium.
You have a sense of ominousness with those fish in the background. It's very weird.
Take me quick.
He uses the background as a kind of comment on the foreground. It has an ominous, strange feeling that totally undermines the romance in the foreground. I think the trial scene is again, rather personal to Wells. He has a real aversion for lawyers.
Didn't you and your husband have an argument about your showing an infatuation for O'Hara?
He hates the authority. There's a general kind of comic tone.
Hey, what happened?
Oh, screw you all the time.
But satirical comic tone to the trial sequence, which I think reflects Orson's own feeling that a lot of that dramaturgy around trials is fraudulent. In Lady from Shanghai, you've got people sneezing and coughing. Generally, it's sort of out of order. He has Erskine Sanford playing the judge.
The jury is so instructed.
Who played the real fuddy-duddy newspaper publisher in Citizen Kane. He's got a shot of the judge, you know, playing chess, and then it cuts to a high angle of the courtroom. And I asked Orson about that juxtaposition, and he thought it was, you know, on the dangerous edge of symbolism, and of course it's right there. It is symbolism, the chess game, the courtroom, it's all chess, it's a game.
Well, I came to in the crazy house. And for a while there, I thought it was me that was crazy.
Well, the funhouse sequence, I think, is another example of Wellesian bravura. Their lives have descended into a kind of funhouse atmosphere, so he puts them in a funhouse. It's out of control. Grotesque. Most of that was cut out. What's left is a kind of a just an hors d'oeuvre of, you know, based on what the meal was. Nobody's seen that, you know, since those days. He himself painted so much of the sets and actually physically did it himself. He liked to do that. He would get into a certain groove working all night and so on. He liked to get into that. Well, he loved to paint, you know. One of the scenes from the funhouse sequence featured a kind of skeletal dummy, skeletal figure that maybe gives you the impression that it might be some grotesque version of Rita Hayworth.
These mirrors, it's difficult to tell. You are aiming at me, aren't you? I'm aiming at you, lover. course, killing you is killing myself.
The whole idea of the mirrors, I mean, it's so close to symbolism that it speaks for itself.
But you know, I'm pretty tired of both of us.
They're shooting each other as images. You know, which one's the real one? They finally do get to the real one by killing each other. It's a very dynamic way of saying what the scene is about. It's the climax of a very kind of theatrical bravura film, a real, you know, thriller finish. The original cut, or the original rough cut of the picture, was 2.5 hours. The released version was barely 1.5 hours. So you'd say about 1 hour was cut out of the picture. So it's a lot. 1 hour is a lot of film. So it's hard to speculate what the movie, what Orson intended.
Never seen anything like that before.
The cuts were based on one or two previews that were held that did not go well.
You ain't kidding.
You can sort of hear what the audiences might have said, that they don't like the characters, that everybody's unlikable, that he's a jerk, she's a bitch. You know, you can imagine. It offended the audiences, or it didn't work for the audiences, so an editor named Viola Lawrence was brought in and did the chopping. Orson wrote a long memo about what he wanted changed, but none of it was paid attention to. So what we're stuck with is a version of the movie that is just an approximation of, or a kind of a tentative. We don't know. But from what Orson said to me, I would think he was not thrilled with the way the picture came out. Well, the music in the picture, it has a theme song, which she sings. And she sings it at one point in the picture. And what Wells objected to was that that is basically the entire score made up of different versions of that one theme. Shanghai got bad notices, and Orson used to say that whenever the subject of the movie came up, people would avert their eyes and change the subject in order to spare his feelings. That nobody ever said anything nice about the movie. He said in America, no one said anything nice about it until Truman Capote told him, you know, sometime in the 50s, that he liked it and had and remembered whole pages of dialogue that he could quote. Other than that, the picture had a pretty good reputation in Europe, as did all of Orson's work. But in America, it was a dismissed movie. When I first saw it 20 years after it was made, at that time, it was not considered to be one of Welles' great films. Today, I think it certainly is an accepted part of the canon. You wish they'd listened to Orson about the memo, and you wish a lot of things, but this is what you got, and there's a lot of good stuff in the picture. By the time that came out, he'd already made another film, which was a very low-budget version of Macbeth, shot on old Western sets, which he did in 23 days. And that was not well received either. So he had two very ill-received films in 1948 and went to Europe and spent almost the next 10 years in Europe. He then came back and made one more studio film, Touch of Evil, another great film noir, although it also was badly reviewed, and that ended his career. I asked him once about why he shot something a certain way, and he said, well, just he thought it was better that way. Why did you shoot that from below? I thought it looked interesting down there. And I said to him, well, you know, whenever I ask you about something being unusual or something in your films, Orson, you always look surprised. He says, yeah, well, because it doesn't seem unusual to me. And he said, then he told me the story about the joke. He says, like the old joke about the guy who goes to the doctor and says, doctor, I'm not feeling well, what's the matter with me? The doctor says, tell me everything you do from the time you wake up until you go to sleep. He says, well, okay, I wake up, I vomit. And wait a minute. The doctor says, well, you get up and you vomit every morning? And the fellow says, yeah, doesn't everybody? So with Orson, he was using that as an example. You know, he said, that's a very unusual shot. Oh, it is? Because that's just the way he saw it. Of course he was ahead of his time. He was very much ahead of his time, from Kane on. Innocent. I said to him, that means being ahead of your time. He says, it means being in trouble. And he was in trouble for most of his career because of that.
The only way to stay out of trouble is to grow old, so I guess I'll concentrate on that. Maybe I'll live so long that I'll forget her. Maybe I'll die trying.